topos?
First, I would like to thank the organizer of this meeting for inviting me to talk here. It's really a pleasure. The title of my talk is a question, and the reason is that I would like to know the answer. By the end of my talk, I will quickly give you a definition. It's a tentative definition. The definition is unfortunately quite long, if I have time, I will explain the axioms. Otherwise, the slides will be available tomorrow or in a few days. Okay, so I guess, okay. First, I will review categorical homotopy type theory. Homotopy type theory is, I would say, a new subject of mathematics, coming from the connection between type theory and homotopy theory. And last year at the Institute for Advanced Study, there was a program organized by Voivodsky on the development of what Voivodsky called univalent foundations of mathematics. And it's an attempt to give a foundations of mathematics based on ideas coming from homotopy theory and formalized with type theory. And it has a connection with higher topos theory because it seems that the natural semantic for this language would be higher topos, or any higher topos. It's sort of the natural that people are thinking that this is type theory should be the natural language for working in a higher topos. We would like for that to really understand what's going on to have a notion of elementary higher topos. So I will review rapidly the notions of topos as higher topos. And I will finish with an attempt to define an elementary higher topos. Okay, so let's look at this from the point of view of axiomatic homotopy theory. G.H.C. Whitehead in 1950 said that the ultimate aim of algebraic homotopy is to construct a purely algebraic theory which is equivalent to homotopy theory in the same sort of way that analytic is equivalent to pure projective geometry. Now, there are many examples of axiomatic system in homotopy theory. The one I know maybe best are started with triangulated categories of Verdier, then homotopical algebra of Quillen, versions of that with Fabrician categories of Ken Brown, and there is something called homotopy theories by Heller, and another thing called theory of derivator, very closely related, by Grothendieck. And then lately we have homotopy type theory, and maybe later in some elementary higher topos theory. So first, I will briefly tell you what is homotopy type theory. I think it's worth to know, especially if you're an homotopy theorist, I think you should know what homotopy type theory is. I don't mean that you should agree with the program of Voivodsky, but you should know what it is. And since I spent some time participating to this program last year, I tried to understand it, and I find it quite difficult because the formal language of type theory is not natural for me. It's a rather strange language, and it makes it hard to think about what's going on if you use this language, at least for an old mathematician like myself. And I have tried to re-express this subject in a categorical form, because that's something I can understand. If I can express something in terms of the language of category theory, I feel that maybe I understand something. So this is what I did. And here on this page, I'm giving you a short history of homotopy type theory, starting apparently with Russell, who developed type theory. I mean, Principia Mathematica is an example. And as you know, it's very hard to read, if not impossible. I think that the only person who actually read Principia Mathematica is Kurt Gödel, the story says. Recently, you have Church, Lovere. Lovere has something to do with the development of type theory. He was with Martin Love in Chicago at the late 60s, and there was other logician there, Howard and Curry, and there was some contact with these people, and I think that Martin Love was inspired by ideas from Lovere. And then recently, Hoffman and Streicher found an interpretation. The funny thing about this language of type theory developed by Martin Love is there was no interpretation. I mean, can you imagine that you have a formal language that you could use for programming computer and etc., but you don't know what it means? That was more or less the situation. Well, of course, you knew that something about it, but there was some rules that were extremely mysterious, and there was no semantic for it. And a semantic was found by Hoffman and Streicher, which is called the Group with Interpretations of Type Theory, and in 1995. And then later, in 2006, Aboudi and Warren. Aboudi was a student of MacLean, but he is in the Department of Philosophy at Carnegie Mellon. Found this homotopy theoretic interpretation of type theory. And in about the same time, Voevodsky also understood that the proof assistant Koch. I mean, Koch is a language, formal language that you can do proof, write proof, using a computer with Koch. And Voevodsky was using Koch in order to do some kind of applied mathematics. He wanted to move into applied mathematics. He was tired of doing pure mathematics. And he started to use Koch, and there he saw that the rules of Koch, which is based on type theory, were about homotopy theory. So he found the homotopy theoretic interpretations of type theory by using the language Koch. Okay, now this is suggested reading. I will have to speed up a little bit, so I will go quickly on some of the slides. But I will give you a copy of these, so you will be able to have the information. Okay, what is categorical homotopy type theory? Here is the picture. It's based on the notions of tribe. I will define what a tribe is. And then there are two notions of tribes. You have pi tribes and H tribe. H4 is for homotopical tribes, and pi is for product. And together you get the notions of Martin Love tribe. And this notion was improved by Voevodsky. And then we get the notions of Voevodsky tribe. And this should lead to the notions of elementary higher topos. Okay, let me define the notions of tribe. First, we need to know what is a quadrable object and quadrable map in a category. So an object in a category C is quadrable if the Cartesian product of this object with every other object or with any other object exists. Okay, that's just a notion. And the same thing for a map. A map is quadrable if the Faber product or base change of this map along any other map exists. So we are going to use base change quite a bit. So the first projection P1 in this square is, of course, called the base change of the map P along the map F. Okay, now here's the notions of a tribe. It's something you're familiar with. So a tribe structure on a category is a class of maps which you could call fabrication. It's a class of fabrication, if you like, satisfying three axioms. First, every isomorphism is a fabrication. And the composite of two fabrication is a fabrication. Second, every map, every fabrication is quadrable. And also, the base change of a fabrication along any map is a fabrication. Okay, something also quite familiar. And then you ask that the map from X to a terminal object, so I'm supposing that the category C is as a terminal object, then that the canonical map X to the terminal object is a fabrication. So in other words, every object is fabrant. Okay. And that's, now we can define what a tribe is. A tribe is a category equipped with terminal object, equipped with a tribe structure. Okay, that's the definitions of a tribe. And we will put axioms on a tribe and obtain various form of tribes from Mertenloff to Voyevodsky tribes. And that's what we are going to do next. First, fabrations and families. One way to look at a fabration is to look at it as a family of objects parameterized by the base of the fabration. Because if you have the fabration P, you can take the fiber of this fabration along a map from the terminal to A, and you get a family of objects of the category, and this is the kind of family, you may call it an internal family, if you like, but you want to look at the fabrations as family of objects. You can compose fabrations, of course, but the idea here is that these fabrations give you families of objects parameterized by variable points of A or elements of A. And a tribe is a collection of families closed under certain operations. This is why I choose the name tribe about this concept. It's a collection of fabrication, that is, of families closed under certain operations. Okay. Now, if you have a tribe, you can define the local tribe at an object A. It's simply the full subcategory of the slice category C over A, whose objects are the fabrication with codomain A. And there is a tribe structure there where a map in CA is a fabrication if the underlying map in C is a fabrication. So again, this is a very familiar kind of construction if you work with Quillen model structures, etc. Okay. Now, let's make the connections with type theory. An object of a tribe is called a type. Okay? It's just a change of terminology. Now, a notation for that. Here is the notation. I'm sorry. Okay, that's the notation. That's a symbol called turnstile. You write E is a type, okay? So this notation of type theorists, they like to write this, right? And actually, you can say, okay, that's declaring that E is an object of a certain tribe, specified tribe. Okay, in addition to types, you have terms. So a map from the terminal object to E is called a term of type E. And that's the notation, you see? Notation for a term of type E. Okay, but there is more. If you have an object of the local tribe, CA, so an object EP, that should be a comma, not dot here. So P is the structure map of this object. So P is actually a map from E to A, okay? Okay, and now this is called a dependent type. And A itself is considered to be the context. And here the notation for a dependent type, you introduce a symbol of variable x, and you say that x is a term of type A, but it's just a variable, okay? And then you have a symbol for the fiber of P at x, okay? And you declare that this is a type, and when you write this whole thing on the computer knows that you have chosen a fabrication from P to A. That's the way to declare that something is a fabrication from P to A. And this is called a dependent type in the sense that the fiber, EX here, is depending on X. It's a variable object. The fiber is a variable object depending on a point of A or a term of type A. This is why it's called a dependent type. And on the left here, it's called a context. Okay. Okay. Now, if you have a section of this fabrication, a section T of this fabrication, it's called a dependent term of type EX. So there's a notion of dependent term. So intuitively, if you have a section of this fabrication, this section will produce a point in the fiber at each point x of the base, you see? And so that starts to make sense, this notation. You're saying that tx is a point of ex where x is a point of the base. Okay, that's just basic language. Now that there is a notion of tribe, there is a notion of homomorphisms of tribe. An homomorphism of tribe is a functor which preserves what you have. So it must take fabrication to fabrication, preserve base change of fabrication, and preserve terminal object. Okay. actually, just a remark that the category of tribes and homomorphism is a two category because there is a notion of natural transformation between the homomorphisms of tribes.
So, is this analogous to like change of universe then for the type theorists? Yeah, exactly.
It's like moving from one universe to another via an interpretation. Okay. Yes. Okay, so an example of homomorphisms of tribe is that if you have a map from A to B in a tribe C, then just base change along this map. Remember that if you have a fabrications over B, then you can do the base change of this fabrication along any map F. It's one of the axioms of a tribe. So there will be a pullback functor or a base change functor from the local tribe at B to the local tribe at A. And this is an example of an homomorphism of tribe by definition. And in type theory, here is what the what people are doing. if you have an object here, you see you have the fiber of this object. It's given by a family, a family EY, where Y is a point of B. So EY is a type which depends on Y being a point of B. So this whole thing here, this sentence, it's called a judgment, right? This judgment in type theory is actually declaring that we have a certain type, an object here. Now, if you pull back this object along F, what you do is a change of parameter. You replace Y by F of X. So F is a map from A to B. So you replace the variable Y by F of X, and you get a new family, okay, depending on X this time. And this new family is just the pullback, is the base change of the map, okay? So type theories don't talk about base change, they don't talk about pullback, but they talk about reparametrization, okay? So when you have a reparametrization here, you have a change of context, you see? This was the old context, this is the new context. An example of that is called context weakening. Because if you do the base change along the canonical map from A to the terminal object, the local tribe at the terminal object is just C itself. So you get a base change from C to the local tribe at A. And what it does is to take an object E in C and crossing with A, and with the second projection to A as the structure map. So that's an example of the homomorphisms of tribe. And in type theory, this is described by a certain deduction rule that if you have a type in C, okay, this is in C, a type in C, E is a type. This type is not depending on anything, so there is nothing on the left here. Then you can introduce a context and not changing anything else. You just introduce on the left-hand side a context. And this operation corresponds to moving from C to CA. It's just pulling back. Why is it that E is the same here? You see, here we have E cross A. It seems that we have done something to E. But no. I mean, we are interested in the fiber of the projection P2. And the fiber of P2 is exactly, all the fibers of P2 are E in the product. And here you're writing the fiber of P2. And this is why it's E again. So there is no change on the right. It's only a change on the left. This is called context weakening. And this kind of homomorphism is interesting. It's called... call it a simple homomorphism, and that CA is a simple extension of C. So moving from C to CA is what I call a simple extension of the tribe. Okay. Now, it's interesting to know that simple extensions are free. They are free extensions. So let's look at this theorem. It's not difficult to prove. It's kind of interesting to know. Sorry, I have a problem with this. Okay. This simple extension, okay, from C to CA is freely generated by a term of type A. You see, it's like a polynomial extension. If you have a ring A, commutative ring A, you can go from commutative ring R. You can go from R to the polynomial ring R bracket X, okay? Polynomial extension of a ring by adding a free variable. Well, the simple extension C to CA is free. Free on what? Free on a new term of type A that you add to A, okay? And this new term, you can describe it explicitly. You see, this new term, it's actually the diagonal of A. I mean, because IA of A, I think I wrote I for IA. I'm sorry about that, because there is an index A here that should be written. or remove this one, but this I is the same as this IA, okay? So IA of A is A cross A, A cross A, okay? And there is the second projection, P2, okay? And now you have the diagonal. And this diagonal gives you a term of type IA. This term is the diagonal. Well, this new term that did not exist in C, but it exists in CA, is free in the sense that if you were to add a term of type A to a type A in a tribe C, what you do is that you go to CA. You get, it's a theorem, right? This can be checked. It has a certain universal property, and it means that the diagonal is generic. Like a variable in a polynomial ring is generic in a sense that you can give to the variable any value in any extension. It's general. Okay, now let's go to summation operation. If you have a fibration in a tribe, then the base change functor, you see the base change functor exists for any map. But if you have a fibration, if you take the base change functor along a fibration, then this base change functor has a left adjoint. And the left adjoint is very easy to describe. It is just the composition with F. So you just compose with F. That's very easy to check, very well known. In particular, the base change functor, the simple extension IA here, okay, has a left adjoint, which I call sigma A. It takes an object E over A to, therefore, it takes a map P from E to A to its domain. So it's, I would say it's the total, this functor is the total space of a fibration. So if you have a fibration over A, this fibration has a total space, and this total space is really the application of sigma A. That's a total space functor. And this total space, of course, the total space of a fibration is a sum of, of its fiber. It's a disjoint union of its fiber, and this is why we adopt this notation. Instead of writing total space, we just write sigma A. This is an operation of summation because you're actually summing the fibers of a family or the elements of a family. So in type theory, there's an operation for that. And this operation it's a symbolic operation. The symbolic operation take a family over A, and you sum it up, and you get a new type. And from the point of view of the theory of tribes, it's very simple. It's just a total space. But there is really no difference between the summation operation and taking total space. And there is also a rule for explaining what is a term. I mean, what is a term of type sum? I mean, so a term of type sum, it will be a pair, AY, where the first index, A, is a term of type A, and the second index is a term of type EA, you see? So that's really the interpretation of a sum. What is an element of a sum, of a disjoint sum? It can be explained as a term, as a pair of two things satisfying this condition here. A is in A and Y is in EA. Okay. So this is called the sigma rule. Sigma rule, okay? Because it tells you how to construct types using the sum operations and also how to construct terms. Okay. Now, there is also I think I already described this by the sigma rule. Yeah, sigma index f. So I already described it. So in general, this sigma rule will be a sum of families along the fiber of f, whatever. Okay. Now let's go to product. Now that we have the sum, let's go to product or section space. So if you have a quadrable object in a category C, then you can define what you mean by the space of section or of a map from P from E to A. Okay. What is the space of section of a map P from E to A? As long as A is quadrable, it makes sense to define this. And what you need for that is an object which I write as product over A of E, okay, equipped with a map. So you should think of pi A of E here as, let's say, in set, it will be the set of all sections of this map from P to E, the set of all sections. Now, if you have a section and if you have a point in A, you can evaluate the section at this point, and you get a value, and the value will be in E. Okay? It will be in one of the fiber of the fabrication. So you need this evaluation map to explain what you mean by this product. Okay, and then this map epsilon has a certain universal property which is easy to describe. Each time you have a map similar to epsilon from C cross A to E, you can find a map from C to the product such that this square commutes. That's maybe familiar to you, but okay. I will go to the next. But there is a formal notion of a product or space of sections of a map as long as in any category, as long as the codomain of the map is quadrable. Because you need the codomain to be quadrable because you need epsilon to be defined on the product here. Okay. More generally, you can define the product of a map along a map. You see, that's what I describe here. So you have a map P, okay, and you want to multiply this map along this map. Intuitively, here is the formula. The result of this operation will be a map sitting over B. Okay, so you go from P to pi E F of E. Okay, that's the result of the operation. But what are the fibers of this map? The fiber at Y is the product of all the EX, the fiber of P, for all X such that F of X is equal to Y. So that's the intuitive, but there is a formal notion for that. Okay. Okay, now I can define you what is a pi tribe. Okay, a tribe is said to be pi close or a pi tribe if the product of a fabrication along a fabrication is again a fabrication. And moreover, if the structure map is a fabrication. I said it in one sentence. You want that the product of fabrations along a fabrication exist, and that this object is a fabrication. Let's go back to the previous slide. You see, as long as P is a fabrication and F is a fabrication, then the product here will exist. And not only that, this map here will be a fabrication. Okay. So this is a pi tribe. Okay. And in type theory, if you have a pi tribe, then symbolically, you have the pi rules for pi rules. It's like the sigma rules to create this product. So if you have a family of types, indexed by a term, x, then you can take that product. It's a new type, and which depend on no terms, you see? This is how type theorists create products. You see, they just go from this line to this line. They have taken the product. Okay, and also there is a rule for creating terms. So if you have a section of this fabrication here, okay? So if you have a term Tx for each type Ex, if you have the first line, you get actually a term of type product. And symbolically, this term is written using the lambda notation introduced by Church. It's called lambda x a tx. It's kind of a good notation after all, although it's not very often used in normal mathematics. Okay, now let's go to H tribe. We know what a pi tribe is. We know what a tribe is. A pi tribe is a tribe with products. Now, we go to homotopy tribes, homotopical tribes. Okay, we need to introduce the notions of anodyne map. A map in a tribe is anodyne if it has the left lifting property with respect to every fabrication. So you may think of an anodyne map as a trivial cofabrication. Okay? But I prefer to call it anodyne because we don't need the notions of cofabrication. We need the notion of maps having the left lifting property with respect to the fabrication. Okay, so here down there I'm explaining what is this left lifting property, and I assume that you know that. So that's the definitions of what an anodyne map is in a tribe. Now, we can pass to the notions of homotopical tribe. Definition. A tribe is homotopical, or an H tribe, if it satisfies two conditions. First, every map admits a factorization as an anodyne map followed by a fabrication. And second, the base change of an anodyne map along a fabrication is anodyne. That's all. That's the two axioms. Okay, that's essentially Metenov type theory had this kind of things in a hidden way. Okay, so what can we do with that? First, of course, we can define what a path object is. So if you have an object in a tribe, in a H tribe, then a path object for A is, of course, the factorizations of the diagonal as an anodyne map followed by a fabrication. And this is the path object, and this is the fabrication of the path object over A cross A. Okay. Now, in Metenov type theory, what you don't have path object. You have something called identity type. It's a special construct. Given a type A, you can construct a new type which depends on A cross A. It depends on two variables, X in A and Y in A. It's a dependent type, but which is sitting over A cross A. And it's called the identity type. Identity XY. So it's here, okay? This is an object depending on XY, A cross A. And it's called the identity type because Metenov was thinking that a term of this type, this is a type, we can look at a term. So a term of this type should be regarded as a proof that x is equal to y. So it's something very interesting in Metenov type theory. Proof are terms. You see, normally in mathematics, we play with symbols and etc. And proof are an abstraction. We don't manipulate the proof as such. We talk about the proof, we argue, etc. But the proof are not like numbers, for example. Okay, but in Metenov type theory, a proof is a term like any other term. Okay. So here, Here, a term of type identity AXY by Martynov is regarded as a proof that X is equal to Y. So you need a proof that X is equal to X. X is equal to X, because we know. And no, but it should be, okay? So this is called the reflexivity term. So there is a special symbol in Martynov tape theory called the reflexivity term. And the reflexivity term of X is a term of type identity XX, okay? It's the proof that X is equal to X. Okay. Now, identity type as a part object. This is what Awoody and Warren discovered in 2006, that the reflexivity term is actually anodyne by the type, by the J rule of type theory. Okay, so let's construct this object here by summing all the identity. So it's like constructing the path space, if you have this interpretation, that identity AXY is the type of all paths from X to Y. Then if you take the total path space, then you will have the reflexivity term, which will define a map from A to the identity A. And you will have a factorization of the diagonal. And by the J rule of type theory, this reflexivity term is anodyne. The J rule of type theory was introduced by Martynov, and he didn't know what he was doing, but he knew it in some sense, but he could not understand the interpretation, but he knew from a computational point of view what he was doing. The J rule of type theory, I'll tell you what is the J rule of type theory. It's simply the rule which says that if you have a commutative square, like the one at the top, so here P is a fibration which is sitting over the path space, and R is the identity, the reflexivity term. And so now suppose that you have a map U from A to E, which is defined by some term, expression. And suppose that this square commutes, it's actually a triangle. Then there is always a certain, this square has a diagonal filler, which is actually a section of P. And this diagonal filler is given by an operation. You have an operation in type theory which produces a diagonal filler to any square, commutative square like this. And this operation is exactly what you need to prove that R is anodyne. I'm sorry? I'm sorry, who's? Okay. could you repeat my ears?
Is there any sense in which the identity type is unique?
No. In type theory, there is a choice, okay? But there is a construction. So you may think of it as an exponentiation A to the I, where I is some interval. See, there's a canonical type path space, okay? But they don't see it as an exponentiation. They see it as some ad hoc operation which produces this identity type from any type A.
Can I ask a question as well? So where does this J operation, this J rule live? I mean, if it's type theory, it's supposed to be somehow, you know, is there a type of diagram?
It's a partially defined operation, you see. I guess you could define a type of diagrams of all that shape, but they don't do that. It's like an ad hoc symbol operation. It's like an algebraic system where you have this special operation which produces a diagonal filler each time you have a square like this. So it's a real miracle that somehow this is exactly what you need to show that R is anodyne. Okay. And now that you have this, if you have an H tribe, you can define what is an homotopic map because you have a path space, which is the identity type, but any path space would do, okay? So, an homotopy between two map, an homotopy H between two map, H is an homotopy between two maps, is regarded as a proof that F is equal to G. That's the type theory proof. I mean, that's I'm not against this interpretation. I mean, why not? I mean, if they want to think that an homotopy between two maps is a proof that F is equal to G, I have nothing against it. But from the point of view of homotopy theory, I prefer to think of an homotopy from F to G as an homotopy from F to G. That's all. Okay. And it works. I mean, you don't need to think that you have proved that F equals G, okay? When you have an homotopy from F to G. A type theorist will maybe believe that, but an homotopy theorist will not. Okay. But that's the only difference. You know, this is a very minor difference, and I hope that this small philosophical difference will not prevent homotopy theorists to be friends with type theorists. Okay, now there is an homotopy category. Since there is an homotopy relation, it's a congruence. You prove it's a congruence, and you can take the homotopy category, and you can define what is an homotopy equivalence. An homotopy equivalence is a map which is invertible in the homotopy category, and it turns out that every anodyne map is an homotopy equivalence. Great. And an object is contractible if the map from X to the terminal object is an homotopy equivalence. Okay. Now you can start to play with this thing. You can define what it means for a map to be homotopy monic. For this, you need to know what is an homotopy Cartesian square. But this you can construct with the path space and etc. So I will not define what an homotopy Cartesian square is, but since you know what is an homotopy Cartesian square, from that you can introduce the notions of homotopy monomorphism. I think that Charles was the first, maybe, to introduce the notions of homotopy monomorphism. I learned it, yeah. Okay. Now, an object is called an H proposition if the map from A to the terminal is a homotopy monomorphism. So an H proposition is somehow describing a subobject of the terminal object in the homotopy category. So typically, the full object or the empty object, so to speak, will be like the true and the false. But you can have values in between. Okay. There is notions of n types. For example, a zero type is called an H set. An object is an H set if the diagonal is actually homotopy monic. Again, this is something rather well known in homotopy theory that you can do this sort of things. Okay, so for Voivodsky, would like to have a foundations of mathematics using type theory. The fact that you can define the notions of set among the types shows that set theory is sort of embedded in type theory, you see. So the theory of sets is a special case of the theory of spaces. But the important thing is the theory of space. It's not the theory of sets. The theory of sets are just special discrete spaces, so to speak. Okay. It's interesting to know that type theorists, they have a notion of homotopy initial object, which is different from what you may think. They say that an object, I don't know how to pronounce the symbol, bottom, an object bottom is homotopy initial if every fibration over it as a section. That's the definition of homotopy initial. They don't ask that this section is unique. Okay? That's very important for them. just every fibration over bottom has a section. And you can show from this definition that the section is homotopy unique, but not necessarily unique. So you only need homotopy uniqueness if you want bottom to be homotopy initial. So there is no need to require the existence of actual initial objects. Okay, there is also a notion of homotopy coproduct, which is similar. the universal property of the coproduct is with respect to the fibration with codomain, the coproduct. So what it says is that if you have a fibration with codomain A coproduct B, and if you have two partial sections of the fibration, so you have F and G, suggest FP is I and GP is J, then you can extend F and G to a section sigma. There exists a section sigma on E which extend F and G, but if you don't ask uniqueness, there's no need to ask uniqueness according to type theorists, because actually you can prove that the section it will be homotopy unique. Okay. There is also a notion of homotopy natural number object. Essentially, an homotopy natural object is an homotopy initial object in a certain category of object equipped with an automorphism and with a point. And it's very much, very close to the usual notions of natural number object, but they don't ask for uniqueness. It's kind of strange the first time you see that. You say, why don't you put it unique? I mean, okay. Now, let's go to Martinov tribe. A Martinov tribe is an H tribe. It has to be an H tribe. Which is also a pi tribe, so it's I, H, and pi, and with the property that the product functor from CA to CB is actually preserved the homotopy relation. Okay, that's something, I mean, it's hard to imagine that pi F could not preserve the homotopy relation, but that's an axiom, and this axiom is called function extensionality. It says something about the fact that if you want to define an homotopy between two maps, you just need to define it pointwise, so to speak, for each value. It's called function extensionality. And that's what I call Martinov tribe. Now let's go to small fibration and universes. So in a tribe, you may have a subclass of fibration called small fibration. So you may think, for example, fibration with finite fibers or something like that, a notion of smallness for fibration. And you need to suppose that the composite of two small fibration is small and that base change of small fibration are small. So that's what a class of small fibration is. And a small fibration is universal. If every small fibration is the base change of this universal one, okay? A universe is the codomain of a universal small fibration. Okay, now what is a Martinov universe? Well, a universe is pi close if the product of a small fibration along a small fibration is small. H close if the path fibration can be chosen small, and if it's both pi close and H close, then I would call that a Martinov universe. Now let's go to Voivodsky contribution of univalent fibration. So suppose that you are in a pi H tribe, okay. If you have two objects of a pi tribe, you can describe the function space, x, y, function from x to y. It's a new type, which represent the map from x to y. That follows from the axioms of a pi tribe. Okay. Now, if in addition that C is an H tribe, then you can describe the object of equivalence between x and y. Okay? Equivalence between x and y. That you can do that in an A pi H tribe. That represents the homotopy equivalences between x and y. Okay. Now, if you have a fabrication P from E to A, then you can describe a new fabrication over A cross A. And intuitively, this new fabrication is simply, which I call equivalence between two fibers of E. It is describing equivalences between two fibers of P. So it's simply equivalence between pi 1 upper star of E and pi 2 upper star of E. This is computed in A cross A. So you can pull back E or P to A cross A, and you take equivalence between these two. And then there's a definition of Voivodsky of univalent fabrication. A fabrication is univalent if the unit map, there is a canonical map from A to equivalence, is an homotopy equivalence. Okay, that's the definition of Voivodsky of univalent fabrication. Now, what does it mean? Okay, what does it mean? Okay, let me introduce the notions of uncompressible fabrication. Okay, Ken fabrication is univalent if and only if it is uncompressible. So what does it mean to compress a Ken fabrication? If you have a Ken fabrication P from X to A, to compress it is to express it as a base change or a pullback along a map, here S, which is homotopy surjective but not homotopy injective. So somehow, since S is homotopy surjective and not homotopy monic, I'm sorry, which is homotopy surjective but not homotopy monic, since S is not homotopy monic, it means that B is constructed from A by some kind of identification. Okay, if you have a map like this, S, and if you pull back a fabrication over B, then you get a fabrication over A, which is compressible, because Y is obtained from X by compressing, by compression. You identify some fiber, so to speak. Now, you can show that every Ken fabrication, every Ken fabrication is the pullback of an uncompressible fabrication, explanatory, along an homotopy surjection. And moreover, the compressed fabrication, the uncompressible compressed fabrication, is homotopy unique. So every fabrication is the pullback of an uncompressible fabrication along an homotopy surjection. And these uncompressible fabrications are exactly the univalent fabrication of Voivodsky. Okay, Voivodsky tribe. Voivodsky saw or proved that the tribe of Ken complexes, which is actually Martin-Love tribe, Ken complexes and Ken fabrication, admits an incompressible or a univalent Martin-Love universe. So there is a universal Ken fabrication. Of course, you have to put some size, define what you mean by small. But once you have done that, there is a universal Ken fabrication. And if you ask this, that this Ken fabrication is univalent, then it's unique, homotopy unique. And Voivodsky tribe is a Martin-Love tribe equipped with a univalent Martin-Love universe, univalent Martin-Love universe. So that's the definitions of Voivodsky tribe. Okay. Now, Voivodsky conjecture. Okay. If you do that, okay, imagine that you have a system containing a tribe, which is a Voivodsky tribe, containing the natural numbers, and close under maybe some kind of homotopy colimit that you need to add. Let's call that Voivodsky type theory, because it's a system where you have symbols that you can put in and natural numbers, and you can construct new objects, and etc. And there is a conjecture that the equality relation between terms in this system is decidable. A computer can tell you if two terms constructed in there are equal or not. And moreover, every globally defined term of type natural number, like here, every term of type natural number, is equal to a numeral, a natural number. Okay, and that's a conjecture. It is, I don't know. Actually, Thierry Coquin now is working on proving this conjecture. He believed that the conjecture is true, it will be proved, but the proof is not complete yet. So, but what it says is that you could work really with a computer to do homotopy theory, for example. Okay. Okay, so just a list of results. Some results, people have worked on this. Unfortunately, most of them are not homotopy theorists. Okay, so they need to learn homotopy theory from the scratch. Shulman has some, I would say, is a category theorist and homotopy theorist, but the others are not. So he was the first to prove the first theorem, pi 1 of S1 is Z. And then Licata proved that pi n of Sn is Z. Licata is a computer scientist. And that pi k of Sn is 0 for k smaller than n. And then Brunnery, who is a student, now a student of Carlos Simpson, yes. A student of Carlos Simpson proved that pi 3 of S2 is Z, which is quite something because you need to construct the up vibration in this system, right? And also the fundamental suspension theorem was proved. So this kind of basic result of homotopy theory seems to be coming out. But there are problems. One problem is that pi 4 of S3, we don't really know what it is. We know it's cyclic. Well, of course, we know it's Z over 2, but we don't know how to prove that it is Z over 2 in this system. And there is no notion of internal simplicial type. Simplicial types, we don't know what it is. It seems to be trivial, but we don't know what is a simplicial type. So there is no notion of a Siegel space, and there is no notion of a complete Siegel space in type theory. And this is clearly, if we don't have that, we won't be able to do modern homotopy theory. Okay, so and that's why I'm asking the question about what is an elementary higher topos. This is a missing stone in this recent developments of higher topos theory, and by elementary I mean essentially algebraic or combinatorial. I don't mean that it is simple, okay? Even elementary geometry, Hilbert axioms for Euclidean geometry has 19 axioms. 19. Elementary Euclidean geometry, 19 axioms. So I was very pleased because my descriptions of what an elementary topos is has 18 axioms. Okay, so, yeah, okay, so Grothendieck topos, elementary topos, Higher topos, they were introduced by Charles Reck and also Lurie with infinity category. And there is a characterization of higher topos in terms of a descent condition. It's a very nice theorem. And there is also characterization by Toen and Fitzosi, and a characterization by Lurie. And here I have a list of things that I would like to be true for an elementary higher topos. Here we need to choose which model of infinity one category will be in higher topos. And so there are many choices, and I don't know which one to take. The only things I was able to choose was a generalized notions of model category. So model category are not good enough. So we need to extend that to something like called pre-model category, introduced by Lumsdaine, and also there is in a paper by Stan Kulescu. Okay, and what is in each topos? So here is the definition. The definition here is it is. There are four groups of axioms, a multiple axiom, H1 to H3, three axioms. And then geometrical axiom, G1 to G7, seven axioms. Logical axiom, L1 to L6, and arithmetical axioms, A1 to A2. Okay. The homotopical axioms, here they are. The important things is this one here. The base change of a cofabration along a fabration is a cofabration. It's very important in a homotopy type theory. It's central, okay? And we seldom use this kind of axiom in Quillen model categories. The geometric axiom, I call them geometric because it's like in topos theory, there is something about the geometric side of the topos or the logical side. So I just maybe point out here, G7, every pseudo-groupoid is effective. This is like the axiom saying every equivalence relation is effective in the theory of topos. But here, I have not defined what is a pseudo-groupoid, but there is a notion of pseudo-groupoid, and you ask this to be effective. And now you have logical axioms. This is about the product, the behavior of the product, and also the behavior of the universe, the property of the universe. And of course, the universe should be univalent, univalent universe. Okay. And there are arithmetical axioms. It's about the natural number. First, you need to have a natural number object. And I want the natural number object to be fabrant. Fabrant, and of course, small, because, okay. Okay, there are easy consequences. Now, there are examples. The category of simplicial sets, the category of simplicial pre-sheave over any elegant Riedeck category by Schulman. And also the category of pre-sheave over any elegant local test category. The notions of elegant Riedeck category was introduced by Charles Reck and you too, right, in a paper, right. Okay, thank you for your attention. Sorry. Okay.